Okay, good morning. Hope you've all recovered. So you have 4 hours of lecture from me this morning, and I'm not sure that either of us can stand it, but the reason is because since you've got this test next week, we wanted to give you Tuesday morning off, so or at least off from micro. Anyway, we've talked about the overall structure of viruses, we've talked about their classification, we've talked about an overview of their life cycle, and then at the end of last lecture, I talked about some things that we're going to see with DNA viruses. And that includes, since we use DNA as our genetic material, we have the machinery for copying DNA into more DNA, and we also have the machinery for copying DNA into message. And so that machinery will be available to these DNA viruses, and that very much affects how DNA viruses run their life cycle, and I hope to make that clearer in the next short time. Okay, so are there any questions so far? Okay, so now I want to go into some of the life cycles of some of the DNA viruses. Again, I can't do everything. What I want to do is discuss some of the major principles, the major life cycles, the kind of ones you're expected to know. But what I want to try and bring out is what are the features that are sort of typical of the things that viruses do. Because when you come to other viruses, you see they do the same things. They're sort of like a set of modules, and they may assemble a different set of modules. But there's a common strategy lying, a common rationale underneath all of this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start off by discussing viruses and the DNA viruses, and the way I'm doing this is in order of genome size, because the smaller they are, the less they do for themselves. So we can start building up what viruses do for themselves on top of your basic virus. And just to give you some idea, the E. coli genome is about 5,000 kilobase pairs, and these are much smaller. Now, I don't expect you to remember the size of these viruses. I'm not going to ask you how many kilobase pairs are they. But I do think it's important to know that we've got larger DNA viruses and smaller DNA viruses, because that very much affects how we can approach them. So I'm going to start off with the parvoviruses. Parvo means small. So these are small DNA viruses, and I'm not going to spend much time on them. I just want to make a couple of comments about their life cycle, because it does affect their pathology. Well, okay. So as I say, parvo means small, so they're really tiny both physically and in terms of their genome. So they don't have a very big nuclear capsid, it's a icosahedral nuclear capsid, and they don't have a very big one because they don't have much to put inside it. And they're single-strand DNA. They're actually, of the viruses that we're going to talk about, they're the only single-strand DNA viruses. Now, one of these things is these are very small. They don't code for very much. So, as I pointed out, our DNA replication machinery is in the nucleus. If you're going to use our DNA replication machinery, you have to go to the nucleus. So it's not surprising that they replicate their DNA in the nucleus. They're going to use our machinery. And for these, some viruses, as we'll see, have a way to turn on cells that are not normally dividing to divide so that the machinery is available, because we only have our machinery during S phase of the cell cycle. So most of our non-dividing cells will not be expressing the genes needed for DNA replication. There's no point. Why waste your time making deoxynucleoside triphosphates and making all the enzymes that you need if you're not going to replicate? So most of our cells are not making these things. So you've got two options. You either go into cells which are making them, or you somehow push the cells into making them. Or alternatively, you make your own things. And we'll see that viruses, DNA viruses, have actually taken all of those steps. But if you're going to do it for yourself, you need a lot of genome, and these haven't got much. So they replicate their DNA in the nucleus, and they go into dividing cells. And the one that is of particular importance in human is one called B19, which is a parvovirus. We'll discuss it briefly later on. It's a relatively mild disease in most people. It can be a problem in the pregnant woman, and it can also be a problem in people who have got some kind of chronic hemolytic anemia. That includes things like sickle cell anemia, but other anemias as well. And the reason for this is, where are our dividing cells? The obvious targets for viruses are the gut And in fact, in animals, veterinarians deal with relatives of this and they cause gastroenteritis. But in the human, this virus, which is a human virus, it's not, we don't get it from animals, we get it from each other. This virus replicates in proerythroblasts. And because of that, it actually kills the proerythroblasts. And so you temporarily have a decrease in red blood cell formation. Now, our red blood cells last for many weeks, so if you've got a few days off from making fresh red blood cells, you might have a slight decrease in red blood cell count, but you're not really going to notice it. So it causes a mild disease in children, and there's really nothing much more to it. But if you've got chronic hemolytic anemia, and your cells are only lasting for a few days, and you don't make them, you can go into aplastic crisis. So this turns out it was a virus that was only recognized relatively recently in the term of the lifespan of a microbiology lecturer. But it's relatively recently that this virus was discovered and realized it was the source for this mystery of where do suddenly all these red blood cells go in sickle cell patients. And they don't actually go anywhere, they're just not being replaced. So it's a problem in certain individuals because it's going into replicating cells. And I think that's all I want to say about that. Any problems? Okay. So we now go up a little bit in size, but really we're just about the same level. The capsids that are a little bit bigger, but we're just about the same level, really, in terms of coding potential. And I want to talk about, briefly about the papillomas, but we're going to really talk about the polyomas. These two, the reason I'm mentioning both of them is these two were originally thought to be related. They've got very similar looking capsid structures. Again, they're icosahedral nucleocapsids. They're non-enveloped, just like the parvoviruses, which weren't enveloped either. And one thing, by the way, to notice is that all the DNA viruses have got icosahedral nucleocapsids, except for the pox viruses, as usual, which are complex. So everything is going to be icosahedral for this lecture. So they're icosahedral. There's a major protein in the virus. I'm not going to expect you to know the names of the individual viruses, but it helps me talk about of the individual proteins. VP means virion protein. So they're structural proteins, i.e. they're present in the virus particle. And so there's a major virion protein, which is the vast majority of what you see, and there are a couple of minor ones, which are important, but they're minor components. And it's got circular double-stranded DNA, so that helps it with replication. And it's associated with histones, and they're our histones. So they package themselves with our histones. And they got a relatively small genome. So it was thought that because everything looked the same, these two were originally the same. And in the older textbooks, you'll see they're grouped into the same family. And I just mentioned it in the handout. It was called the papovirus family. These two have been split for a long time, but occasionally you will see people refer to papoviruses, and that's just because it's papilloma and polyoma viruses. But I'm going to talk about the polyoma, just briefly mention the papilloma. They grow in epithelial cells and are associated with warts, and in some cases this is cancer, and of course you're all familiar, I assume, with human papillomavirus and its connection with cervical cancer. But that's only certain human papillomaviruses, and not everybody who gets an infection gets cancer. So I'm not going to talk about their life cycle. I'm going to talk about polyomaviruses because they're a good sort of basic example of how these viruses go about life. And if you understand these, then you can apply it to a lot of other viruses should you need to. Human polyomaviruses, members of this family, poly, by the way, means a lot of omas, i.e. A lot of tumours. In humans, these don't cause tumours, at least as far as current knowledge is going. In tumours, we seem to have got better defences against tumours than small animals. But in hamsters and mice, some of these viruses can cause a lot of tumours. And so they were called polyoma. But fortunately, they don't seem to be oncogenic in humans. So they get tumours in animals, but the disease that's the more significant one in humans, which we'll be discussing in the last of my lectures, is a disease called progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy, which is a progressive degradation of the white matter in the brain. And this is a pretty sick-looking specimen here. And it's a progressive disease, and it's really nasty. It used to be extremely rare, but with the advent of a lot of immunocompromised people around, it's becoming much commoner, unfortunately. And I'll talk about the diseases in the later lectures. I just want to give you some idea so that you can tie these viruses into where they're going to fit in later on. Icosahedral capsid, as I said, it's a DNA virus, so they're all going to have it. And the one that's been most studied is SV40. And this is a simian virus. It was called SV because it's simian. V because it causes vacuoles when it grows in cells. Remember I talked about cytopathic effects. A typical one of this is it causes vacuoles. And it was the 40th simian vacuole. I don't know whether it was the 40th simian virus isolated or the 40th simian vaculating virus isolated. But anyway, everybody knows about SV40 because it was what was worked on. And that's one of the things that you'll find with viruses, unfortunately. People worked on the ones that were easy to grow back in the days when a lot of this work was first done. So it's kind of like the drunk and the lamppost. You know, he's looking for his keys and the policeman comes up and says, you know, can I help you, sir? And he says, I'm looking for my keys. And the policeman can't find them either. And he says, are you sure you dropped them here? And the guy says, no, I dropped them on the other side of the road, but the light's better here. And that's what we tend to do in research, unfortunately. We often look at the ones that we can handle and that are safe and that aren't going to kill us, rather than the lethal ones that are difficult to grow. So we extrapolate, which is what I'm hoping you'll be able to do once you've gone through these cycles. But it's how things work. I used to work on a virus that's relatively safe. It's a relative of rabies, and I tell you, my fellow faculty member wouldn't be too pleased if I got rabies going in the lab, so you have to be careful. Anyway, there's some more viruses that we'll come to later on. I'm just putting them here so that when you revise, you remember. And we're going to talk about the lytic cycle. This virus can apparently hang out in cells in some way or other, and in the tumours it can be integrated into the genome. We don't really know about how it hangs out in humans. But I'm going to talk about the lytic cycle. In other words, the productive cycle where it ends up by cells being lysed and it gets out of the cell. So it's the productive cycle. If you look at the capsid here, here's the hexons, and then here's the penton. So this is a beautiful football model type of virus. Soccer ball. That's British for football. Okay. So I said we'd go through the life cycle. I'm going to try and sort of remind you of the whole life cycle, but we're going to focus on mainly the nucleic acid sides of these and gene expression. But it binds to the cell surface. It got taken in by endocytosis. That seems to be how, as I say, the vast majority of viruses seem to be to use our endocytic pathways. The endocytic vesicles become acidified, and somehow, and we don't know in this case, the nuclear capsids appear in the cytoplasm. And one thing, as I mentioned, is you've got these minor virus proteins called VP2 and VP3, and somehow, probably as a result of this acidification, they undergo a conformational change, and they become exposed on the outside, and they have nuclear localization signals. So remember I said these viruses have to obey our rules or they have to learn how to bend them. And we have these signals on our proteins that say, take me to your nucleus. And what these viruses do is they just mimic those signals. And in fact, in many cases, those signals were first found in virus particles because we wondered how they got to the nucleus. And they're easy to work with, at least years ago, before we have the current techniques. Anyway, so the nuclear capsid has a thing that says, take me to your nucleus. And they land up at the nuclear core, and then the DNA goes into the nucleus. But the nuclear capsid apparently doesn't go through the nuclear pore. It doesn't seem it's got the mechanism to get through the nuclear pore. It's got the mechanism to get to the nuclear pore. So somehow the DNA, and as I say, it's a double-stranded circular DNA associated with host cell histones, gets into the nucleus. And so as far as our machinery is concerned, it looks like double-stranded DNA coated with human histones, and we regard it as being just like any other double-stranded DNA. So it's nothing special. We don't recognize foreign DNA. it just looks like our DNA, especially when it's coated with the right proteins. So what happens in the lytic cycle? Now, generally for these nuclear DNA viruses, you'll find, or for actually for most of the DNA viruses, you'll find that there's an early stage and a late stage. And I'll try and stress the logic behind this more as we go through. But the early stage is setting the scenery. So it's kind of like sending out a small force to investigate the country. You sort of look around, you change a few things, and then when everything's ready, you get the big guns in. So what tends to happen in the early phase is proteins, you make proteins that are going to be needed to replicate your DNA. You make regulatory proteins that tend to change the conditions in the cell to make it more favourable to replicate your DNA. And then you often, these proteins alter the properties of the host cell to make it more favourable. Not necessarily, but very frequently. And obviously, once a virus starts messing about with what your host cell is doing, you're on the road to having a sick host cell. And this can be the basis of a lot of the viral pathogenesis. Then the late phase starts, and the late phase, by definition, is the onset of DNA replication. So if it's the onset of DNA replication, everything that's essential for DNA replication has to be made in the early stage, otherwise you'll never go into the late stage. So the late stage is DNA replication, and now is when you start making lots of viral proteins to assemble new virus particles, and so the cell suddenly starts becoming a huge factory. For many of these viruses, a few viruses can tick away, but most of these viruses that we're talking about make huge amounts. So you get the new structural proteins, and then you're ready to go and assemble new virus particles. So I'm going to start off by talking about the early phase. So we've got this double-strand DNA in the nucleus, and it looks perfectly good. And the host cell polymerase combine to it and make a message, which I've shown in red. Starting, I don't expect you to know these numbers, but it's easy for me because I know you're looking at computers and things. It starts at about 69, 67 on the genome. And around there, there's an early promoter, and that early promoter actually can make a ton of message because it's got a really efficient enhancer close to it. So this enhancer is a really potent one, and in fact it's used in a lot of genetic engineering, gene therapy type of stuff in order to get huge amounts of an RNA from a particular promoter. So we use it a lot in terms of wanting to make lots of these recombinant DNA things. But this SV40 enhancer is a very potent one. So even though you've only got one infectious virus particle in the nucleus, you're actually making a lot of message from it. And it makes lots of copies of this primary transcript. And the primary transcript is polyadenylated, and it's capped and methylated at the 5' end, polyadenylated at the 3' end. So it looks like a regular message. And it doesn't actually make it to the cytoplasm as this. It has to be spliced, it has to have introns removed, just like our messages. And of course, that requires a lot of machinery, but this virus is in the nucleus, so the machinery is around. And so, if one intron is removed, there's an open reading frame. This is the beginning, the 5' end of the message. So this will be beginning at the protein here, the amino terminal. And it will translate a protein which goes to where this black arrow finishes. There's a stop code on there. And that protein will be produced by this message. That protein is called the T antigen because this protein is expressed in tumours in the animals. It can undergo an alternative type of splicing when the dotted line indicates the introns, when this bigger intron is removed, and that intron removes the area which had the stop code on for the small T antigen, and it now makes a much larger protein because the open reading frame is maintained all the way around to this black arrow here. And now it makes a much bigger protein, which is called, and you wish people had a little bit more imagination, it's called the large T antigen. So every time you talk about it, you have to say, this is the small T or the large T. I'm not going to talk anymore about the small T. It appears to play a role in the non-lytic cycle in animals, and I'm not really going to go into that very much. The large T antigen is what I'm going to focus on here, because this plays a crucial role that we want to discuss in the life cycle, the lytic cycle. So the message is alternately processed, some to make the small T antigen, some to make the large T antigen. And the small T antigen presumably has roles, but as I say, I don't want to talk about that. Both of these messages are exported to the cytoplasm just as regular messages. They're translated just as regular messages. And the large T antigen and the small T, actually, both have nuclear localization signals on them. So the large T antigen is put back into the nucleus. So again, you know, if you want to parasitize the host cell, you give signals that the host cell can recognize. So the large T antigen comes back into the nucleus, and it binds to this DNA. And this is necessary because this is going to play a crucial role in DNA synthesis. Now, if you go back all your way in your mind to your biochemistry and to the DNA, when you start DNA synthesis, there's something called an origin of replication. And in eukaryotic cells, that is recognized by a protein complex. And I don't know whether you went into this in your biochemistry, but we have a protein complex that recognizes an origin of replication. So our replication of our DNA is highly organized. It only starts at certain places on the genome, and those places are recognized by this complex. Once that complex recognizes it, the DNA polymerase and all the other things assemble, and DNA synthesis proceeds. The SV40 does not have an origin of replication that our origin of replication complex would recognize, and actually at this stage the cell probably isn't even replicating, so it wouldn't be around anyway. So this T antigen binds to the DNA, and once it's bound to the DNA, our machinery recognizes this as being a message, this is an origin of replication. So it triggers our machinery to recognize this as a genuine origin of replication. So if you don't have a start, you're not going to make any DNA. So this basically is now recognized by our DNA polymerase as being an origin of replication. And so it uses the host cell DNA replication machinery, and it uses host cell histones to package it as it's made. And the way it's made is just the way that our DNA is copied. So it's leading and lagging strands and RNA primers and Okazaki fragments and ligases. If you don't remember it, please refresh your memory. So it's just regular DNA synthesis. And because this is circular, it doesn't have the problems of what do you do at the chromosomal ends. And if you, I don't know whether you've discussed it, but we have telomeres at our end, which are kind of a complicated way so that we don't keep moving in and in from our ends and losing a bit of DNA each time we replicate. If you have circular DNA, you don't have that problem. Okay, so this is copied into another double-stranded DNA circle using all our machinery, topoisomerases included. And that circle, there's now, as I said, there's a lot of big T, large T antigen around. So the large T antigen binds to this circle, so both of these can now be replicated. And now you'll get four copies. So you go from one to two to four. You double each time. And I just wanted to show you the power of doubling, because actually this is important in so many things. So I tried to make it financially interesting. So supposing, and I'm not going to do this because I'm not head of some big Wall Street firm and there's no way I can afford to do it, but supposing I came in today and I gave each of you a dollar and I said, I'll give you twice as much tomorrow. Now, given the turnout, I could probably afford to give each of you a dollar, and I might even be able to afford to give each of you $2 tomorrow. But in about a week's time, you will be getting $128 a day, which is kind of nice, I agree. But, you know, it's not like you're going to retire on that or anything. But if we look a week later, you're now getting $16,000 a day. And if we look a week later than that, you're now getting hundreds of thousands of dollars a day. You can pay your med loans off. You can buy whatever car you want. You can do lots of things. So my point is, just by doubling, the initial rounds of replication, you kind of keep under the radar. Nothing much is happening. But once you start getting big, you get big very quickly. So this is what I was saying about you start off by keeping under the radar, and then you kind of explode out of everything. But this is the same thing, by the way, in epidemiology. If you infect two people and those two people infect two people each, and those two people infect two people each, you have exactly the same thing. Something that starts off small suddenly explodes and you've got an epidemic, because if you can double the number of people infected every day, initially it doesn't look like much, and then all of a sudden you've got everybody sick. Anyway, eventually it runs out of substrate, so it doesn't keep on going, but it can very rapidly, because these things replicate in a few minutes, it can very rapidly, once it takes off, take off really quickly. So as we say, you then end up with the DNA, with the T antigen package with host cell histones, looking for all the world like any other stretch of DNA in the nucleus, except for the T antigen, but as I say, we recognise that as an origin of replication. So now you've got lots of DNA. You want to make lots and lots of message in order to make lots and lots of nuclear capsids and assemble new virus particles. So now that we've replicated the DNA, we started the late phase. The late phase started when we replicated the first DNA. So we're now in late message synthesis. So what happens in late message synthesis? Well, same virus, same enhancer, it's still around here. Remember, enhancers can work in either direction. They can promote transcription from a promoter on either side of them if there's a suitable promoter. And there is here. So the T antigen binds here, and there's a promoter that's on the other side of the T antigen. And it works, this promoter here, which is a little bit closer to the 70 side than was the early promoter. This promoter works really well when T antigen is bound. When T antigen isn't bound, it doesn't work very well. So the T antigen is a promoter, increases the activity of the late promoter. So now you've got T antigen, you can now express the late genes, and again, there's lots and lots of copies of this primary transcript. And again, that is capped and methylated and polyadenylated. It looks like a message, any other message. And again, it is spliced before it gets out to the cytoplasm. And so one splice moves this dotted region here, and the first start codon, you make a protein called VP2, which was one of those minor virion proteins. If you take out a bit more, you can make the VP3, and actually VP2 and VP3 are in the same reading frame. So VP2 has just got more at the amino terminal than VP3, which is sort of the opposite that we saw in the early phase, where the T antigen had got more at the large T antigen had more at the C terminal end than did the small T antigen. I'm not going to quiz you on which of these proteins have what. I just want you to get the concepts here that we've got alternate processing, and that you can make proteins which have got common amino terminal, a different C terminal, which have got common C terminal, different amino terminal. Or what we have is an even more different protein. If we take out this big exon here, then when we splice this, the first start codon that it will find is up here, and you make this protein called VP1, and that's got a very broad arrow because that's the majority of the protein that you're going to make. So VP1 is the major component of the nuclear capsid. So this is the favoured one. And it actually starts right up here and goes over here, so its amino acid sequence is not in common with VP2 and VP3. It's a completely different protein. So here you've got one message making three proteins. Two of them are related, and the other one is something completely different. And I just want to show what happens here, because again, this is a feature of some of these viruses. So what happens up here? Why have I got this cross-hatched region? And I'm just going to show that since we've got the sequence of it, it's much easier to think about this as sequence. Do not learn the sequence. I don't want you to learn all this stuff. But again, this is learn the concept. So the concept here is that these proteins are in different reading frames. And VP1 actually starts before VP2 and VP3 finish. So if you look at the sequence here, this is the actual sequence of SV40 in this region. And this is the start codon for VP1. So it's got methionine at the beginning, because proteins always do start with a methionine. And that's coded for by AUG, and that's about that codon I can always remember because it's in the word inaugurate. So you inaugurate protein synthesis here on AUG. And then you read in every three, so it's alanine, proline, threonine, lysine, etc., and you make VP1. If you look at what's happening on VP2 and VP3, these ribosomes are in a different reading frame and they started way back down here. And when they come, they're not reading AUG, they're reading GAU, and they're putting in aspartate, glycine, proline, asparagine, lysine. So they have got different, what we've got is an overlapping reading frame where we're making two different proteins of the same message. I mean, is this efficient or what? And a lot of viruses do this. It's a way when you've only got a small amount of nucleic acid to get a lot of bang for the buck. We do it in some places, but as I say, viruses do it extensively. But what that means is if you have a mutation in this area, it's going to affect both VP1 and VP2 and VP3, because if it's a mutation which changes the amino acid here, it can possibly also change the amino acid here. So this puts real constraints on these viruses as to what they can afford to mutate. So this is one of the reasons why we can make these viruses attenuated, some of them quite easily, because if you do a mutation, you can actually affect multiple proteins simultaneously. So that may not be good, because sometimes the viruses do the damage are the ones that aren't lytic. If you're lytic and you kill the host cell, then any changes you might have had, say, on the tumorigenesis side, are negated because the cell's dead. But anyway, we do have this thing that viruses can have to maintain a remarkably constant regions when they've got this kind of thing where they're doing overlapping stuff. Okay, any questions? How does it start making what?
How does it have a start codon that's not AUG?
It does have a start. Its codon is AUG. The start codon here is AUG. The start codons for VP3 and VP2 were down here, and they were AUG. So what routinely happens, and we'll be going over this, but there's capped methylated messages, and the simplistic model, which is a generalization but true for, by and large, for most of our RNAs, is that we bind one of the subunits binds to the 5' end and scans along until it finds an AUG. And when it finds the AUG, the second subunit comes in, you assemble your ribosome and you start protein synthesis. So here, the ribosomes all get on here. This part is missing in this RNA, and then they see a start codon here. This is a different start codon. So that's how you can play these games. Any other questions? Okay, so I'm trying to stress how these viruses do a lot of tricks to maximize what they get out of their genome. And these tricks you see in most of these viruses, not all of them use the same ones, but they've got a bag of tricks and they sort of take various ones out of the bag. We've got all these things going on in our cells, but the viruses, as I say, use them very heavily because, as I say, the genome is small and they seem to have developed such that they can get an awful lot done by a very few nucleotides. So one of the things that you see a lot in viruses are multifunctional proteins. Now, we have multifunctional proteins. But as I say, viruses are very obvious specialists in this. And one thing is to think about the roles of the large T antigen. We've already said it's involved in binding to the DNA origin of replication so that our complex recognizes it as an origin. So it plays an important role in DNA replication. It's involved in increased transcription of the late genes because without that there, that late promoter really doesn't function at all. So it's involved in late gene transcription. One thing I haven't yet commented on, but transcription of the early gene, which comes from promoter on the other side, is actually inhibited by that T antigen binding. So it decreases transcription of the early genes because you don't need the T antigen so much now. You've already got lots of T antigen and you've replicated your DNA. So it's just a waste of material to keep on making a lot more of your early genes. So very frequently with these viruses, you see that when you switch on the late genes, the genes that you make after replication, which are the ones you need to assemble the new nuclear capsids, you also switch off the early genes because they're no longer needed, and it's just a standard way to do things. And one thing I haven't commented on yet is that T antigen also interacts with cellular proteins. And we're not, as far as humans are concerned, this isn't so important for us because we seem to be fortunately not susceptible to tumours caused by this. But there are similar proteins in other DNA viruses, including the papillomaviruses. There are similar proteins. And what this particular one does is it binds to one of our transcription factors that is involved in pushing the cell into S phase, and we get pushed into S phase. I don't want to go into the mechanisms here. But our cells get pushed into S phase. So the cells start making all the components for DNA synthesis. It doesn't necessarily push you into DNA synthesis, but everything's there for DNA synthesis because not only is it going to need DNA polymerase, topoisomerase, primase, ligase, all these sort of things, it's going to need a lot of histones. And we don't make these histones, the regular histones, except in S phase. We make very few histones out of S phase. And we also need the nucleoside triphosphates. Now, we don't bother to take deoxynucleoside triphosphates unless we're about to replicate our DNA, because what's the point? It's just energy going to waste. So this protein pushes you into S phase. Now, the problem is once the cells get pushed into S phase, there's a danger that they will carry on and start replicating. And what we also have is we have various gateway mechanisms that recognize that the DNA synthesis is about to occur and it shouldn't be, and they tell the DNA to stop, the cell to stop going into DNA synthesis. And if the cell still insists on going into DNA synthesis, they tell the cell to commit apoptosis, so commit suicide and stop being bad. That's not good for SV40 because it wants to be able to hang around until it can make all its nuclear capsids, lyse the cell and get out. So it also has a protein which prevents some of those preventative mechanisms, so it counteracts them. So now you've got a virus which is trying to push the cell into S phase, so it has all the substrates and enzymes it needs, and also trying to stop the cell recognizing that there's something bad going on and committing apoptosis. So you've got these two mechanisms. In this case, for this particular virus in humans, that's apparently not a problem. But, as I say, it's if you've got cells that are replicating and that are inhibited from committing apoptosis, you have a benign tumour if it keeps on going. And if any of those cells start getting mutated and you're suppressing the standard standard gateway pathways, if some of them turn more carcinogenic, they may be able to escape. And you've now got a grounds for getting a tumour. If cells don't replicate in the adult, then they're not going to cause a tumour. And so you can get malignant tumours from some of this kind of thing. It's just a side effect of what the viruses are trying to do for themselves, to cover their rear ends and get what they want out of the cell. So you can get what's called transformation of cells, whereby they become able to divide and grow when they shouldn't be, and that may be just benign. I mean, after all, that's what warts are, and by and large, most warts are benign. But it can be a lead eventually, in some cases, to cancer. Fortunately, in this case, not in us, as far as we know. So the large T antigen is responsible for that. So it's doing an awful lot of things. So talk about multifunctional. Okay, so these VP messages go out to the cytoplasm. They're translated into proteins. The proteins are shipped back into the nucleus because viral capsid assembly is going to go on in the nucleus. And that's what you see for these DNA viruses that replicate their DNA in the nucleus. And one simplistic, probably, but one way to think about this is that we don't ship our DNA out of the nucleus into the cytoplasm. We keep it in the nucleus where it's relatively safe and protected. The cytoplasmic environment has got much more in the way of things like free radicals, many more reactive chemicals. The DNA is being kept away, protected. It's, as I say, it's the family jewels and you look after it. So it's locked away in the vault of the nucleus. And we don't have mechanisms for getting DNA out of the nucleus. So these viruses, apparently they've taken the option, rather than trying to find a way to get their DNA out of the nucleus, it's easier a way to find a way to get the proteins into the nucleus, because we do that all the time. Tons of proteins go into the nucleus, ribosomal proteins, histone proteins, all of those go into the nucleus for assembling new DNA and new RNA. So getting these things into the nucleus is not a problem. So what you find is the capsid proteins go into the nucleus and you assemble new capsid particles. They're self-assembly and they assemble and package the DNA and you get new virus particles formed. One thing that I haven't commented on yet, and I'll show you some pictures of some other viruses later on, but these are very regular nuclear capsids. So basically it's like having, you know, a pile of oranges or something in the nucleus. You've got these huge numbers of these nuclear capsids. And they form these nice little arrays where they're all basically set out like you'd see in a grocery store for oranges. So they're all neatly arranged. And I guess if you were in a helicopter and looking down on a big fruit stand, what you would see is all these oranges, and they would look like crystals. They're all in a regular array, and it's called paracrystalline array. So you see these paracrystalline arrays in the nucleus, because what these viruses do is they assemble huge numbers of nuclear capsid particles, way more than they need. They're not concerned. Their idea is the cell is going to lyse soon and get them all out of the nucleus. These aren't enveloped. The only way they're going to get out of the cell is to have the cell lyse. So they're not concerned about being efficient in terms of using every last protein. They just make a ton of all of them. They're not, so as long as there's plenty made, it doesn't really matter about whether you make 100 molecules of VP2 and VP3 or 105 or anything. There's no real necessity to really control the relative amounts of VP1, VP2 and VP3 other than very crudely. And so, because you're going to assemble so much. So a lot of these particles are assembled, and not all of them get DNA inside them. So that's one reason why you look in the EM, you'll see a lot more particles than you see DNA, than you see infectious particles. So the part, I said, you know, when you release these things, not every particle is infectious. Some aren't infectious because they didn't get the DNA in. So they lyse the cell and they get out. Standard way for a non-enveloped virus to get out of the cell. So what do I want you to note about SV40? I mean, this isn't everything you need to know, but I'm hoping this will give you an overview of it. It has early and late functions, very typical of DNA viruses. It makes multiple use of the same sequence, ditto. It has the T antigen is extremely multifunctional. Again, something else that you see. So if you know one function for a viral protein, you often don't know anywhere near all of its functions. It has a small genome. It makes very few proteins, actually, but in doing so, it manages to do a remarkably good job about making new virus particles. And it uses the host cell very heavily. We provide the DNA synthesis machinery. We provide the RNA synthesis machinery. That includes the polymerase, so it's our regular Pol-2 that it uses to make its RNA. And all the capping, methylation, polyadenylation machinery, and all the splicing machinery, and everything to get it out of the into the cytoplasm. And then it also uses host cell histones to actually package it. So are there any questions there? Okay, so I want to change your virus particles. And I tell you what, unless it's a problem with you, why don't I just sort of take little breaks. We're going to cover a lot of viruses this morning. And since I've got the whole 4 hours, why don't we just take a break between the different viruses so that we don't keep changing? So let's take a 10-minute break here. So if you can be back at 5:02, that would be great.